Welcome to the webinar. My name is Brian Fox. I'm a senior applications engineer here with Flow Science. And today we're going to be talking about how to set up and run sediment transport models in Flow-3D Hydro. So this is actually the fifth webinar of the year for Flow-3D Hydro. So we started out with a review of our free surface modeling capabilities and have been progressively tackling more complex topics such as our 2D, 3D hybrid models, and also our scalar and plume transport modeling capabilities. So if you missed any of these previous webinars, you can access recordings of these from our website and also sign up for some of these future sessions we have scheduled for the rest of the year. So the focus of today's webinar is going to be on our sediment transport modeling capabilities. And so for me personally, this is a really exciting topic to present on, one that I've wanted to do for quite a while now, as I think Flow-3D has some really unique and advanced capabilities in sediment transport modeling by leveraging our 3D hydraulic solution. And so with today's webinar, our goal is to provide a general review of some of the fundamental capabilities of Flow-3D Hydro in the area of sediment transport modeling. So we'll start off with just some general background information on Flow-3D, first starting off with our 3D hydraulic capabilities, and then discussing our sediment transport modeling capabilities. And then we'll walk through a setup example to give you an idea of what's all involved in setting up and running one of these models. We'll also take a look at some of the outputs so we can evaluate some of the different ways that we can look at the results. And then we'll take a look at a few of the validation cases that we've been working on, and also finish up with a quick summary of capabilities and also a discussion of some of the possible model limitations. So this is something that's always going to be important to consider whenever you're doing any type of sediment transport modeling, whether in Flow-3D or any other type of software. So first, before jumping into our sediment transport capabilities, I want to give a very brief general overview of Flow-3D for those who are not familiar with the software. So Flow-3D is a general purpose CFD software. It solves the fully 3D non-hydrostatic Navier-Stokes equations. And we have 40 years of development. So really one of the oldest and most well-established commercial CFD codes out there. Additionally, our core capabilities are for transient free surface flows using our volume of fluid method. And we're used extensively in a wide range of different application areas, including water environmental applications within civil engineering. And then lastly, we just released a new version of our software called Flow-3D Hydro. So this is a version that's focused specifically towards these water environmental civil applications. And so with Flow-3D Hydro, we of course retain all of the advanced 3D free surface modeling capabilities, but then also have optimized workflows specific for civil engineering applications, along with additional advanced physics, application-specific support services, and also expanded training and learning materials. And so if you're interested in a more in-depth general overview of Flow-3D modeling capabilities, I'd recommend checking out the recording of one of our previous webinars by my colleague John Windelbow. And so probably the most basic and fundamental application in Flow-3D Hydro is what we call the basic free surface modeling. So these are 3D simulations of water flowing over some type of solid object, as demonstrated here in this video on the right. And so this is probably the most common type of application in Flow-3D. It's relatively simple and fast to set up, and also very robust with the implementation of our free surface methods. And so this is also typically the starting point for new users, and you may never even need to progress beyond this type of modeling, depending on the goals and objectives of the projects that you're working on. Additionally, it's the basis for more complex applications such as sediment transport modeling. And so we discussed how to set up these types of models in detail in our first two webinars this year. So if you're a new user or just getting started with Flow-3D as a prerequisite for sediment transport modeling, I'd highly recommend checking out the recording from these first two webinars from this link available on our website. So additionally, even though the setup procedure for these free surface models is relatively simple, I do just like to kind of point out the versatility of a general 3D solution is going to allow for the application across a very broad range of different types of complex hydraulic structures where 3D flow effects are going to be important. So here you can see a few different examples of our general free surface simulation with Flow-3D Hydro. And then moving beyond the basic free surface setup, we can add additional complexity using one or more of our additional physics models. So with these options, what we're going to do is activate these additional physics that are going to be coupled with the 3D hydrodynamic solver. So we started looking at some of these options last session with the scalar variable density and heat transfer model for simulating plumes and other types of transport phenomena. So these types of multi-physics models are really one of the great strengths of 3D CFD modeling, in that it's going to allow us to evaluate the full interaction of the 3D flow field with some additional complex physical processes. Okay, so now let's take a look at some of the key features of our sediment transport model. So the first thing to note, that is a fully 3D mobile bed sediment transport model. So within the model, any surface can be defined as an erodible bed that's going to be able to deform or change shape based on an applied shear stress calculated by the hydrodynamic solver. So looking at the video on the right, we have a conceptual example of a plunge pool scour for flow over a simple weir configuration. And so you can see the channel bed eroding and the formation of the scour hole. The red areas define scour regions and the blue colored areas define where we're seeing deposition relative to the initial elevation. Additionally, the model's fully coupled with the hydrodynamic solver. So at each time step, the flow field is going to be solved based on any geometry changes due to the sediment model. So for this same simulation, we can see the 3D flow vectors colored by velocity and also a 2D slice down the channel profile. So here we can observe how this flow field is changing and reacting in response to the bed elevation changes. The model also has full capabilities for both bed load and suspended load transport, along with interaction between the solid or packed bed phase with the suspended sediment phase through erosion and deposition processes. So here in the video, you can see a 3D volume rendering and also some cross-sections and profiles of the suspended sediment concentration in the flow. So in this case, simultaneously, the channel is eroding through bed load transport, and then there's also sediment that's actively being entrained or lifted from the packed bed into suspension. And then that suspended sediment is transported via advective processes, and they can also settle back out and reform the packed bed. So this is really evident at the inlet where we define a suspended sediment concentration as part of the upstream boundary condition. So that sediment's going to settle out and deposit upstream of the weir. And then lastly, we also have the capability to define a variable sediment grain size distribution. So in this video, we can see the channel bed is now colored by the D50 or median grain size. So now as the simulation progresses, we can see the grain size actually change on the surface as the smaller grain size fractions are transported and carried downstream. Okay, so now that we have some information on the key capabilities of the model, let's review a few specific applications of the sediment transport model in Flow-3D. So of course, the ideal application is going to be for situations where we have significant interaction between 3D hydraulics and sediment transport. So these are going to be the situations where a simpler 1D or 2D hydraulic model are not going to be capable of accurately resolving the hydraulics that are driving sediment transport processes. So the most common case is likely to be scour associated with some type of hydraulic structure. So in the example that we see here, we can see the scour hole developing at the outlet of this structure and also some general scouring occurring in the channel bed downstream where flow is converging. And we can also evaluate various types of design changes. So in this example here, we can see we have a non-erodible riprap layer placed downstream of the outlet. And we can see how this affects the erosion and deposition patterns at the outlet of the structure. Then additionally, we can also use the model for suspended sediment studies to evaluate deposition patterns or perhaps sediment removal efficiency, such as for this case of this sediment capture basin. So now let's just talk a little bit more about how the sediment model works before jumping into the setup example. So the basis for everything that we do with this model is going to be the 3D hydrodynamic solver. So of course, part of the fundamental output of a 3D model is going to be our 3D velocity field. And with this type of output, we can calculate the advective transport of suspended sediment. And then we can also calculate a bed shear stress, which is going to be used by both the bed load and entrainment equations to calculate the rate of transport and bed erosion. And so when the sediment model is activated, we'll now be solving an additional conservation equation that's going to account for changes to the packed bed. So in each cell along the packed bed, we'll calculate the rate of change of bed elevation as a function of both bed load transport flux and also the net entrainment or lifting of the packed bed into suspension. And then we can also have deposition where the suspended sediment is going to settle out and reform the packed bed. And then for suspended sediment, we treat this as a scalar quantity, and that'll be transported as a general scalar using the advection diffusion equation. And then we also add an additional vertical component of velocity to account for the settling velocity based on grain size. So to summarize, whenever the model is active, at every time step, we're going to be calculating all of these individual processes individually, which will collectively account for the change in the packed bed morphology and also scalar transport of suspended sediment. So again, this is going to include bed load transport, which typically represents larger particles moving by rolling, sliding, or bouncing, entrainment of packed bed particles into suspension, so scouring deposited sediment into suspension, advection and settling of suspended particles. And we can also define a critical angle of repose. This will account for the natural sliding or collapse of that slope as it approaches that critical angle. And then lastly, I want to point out that the bed load, entrainment, and settling equations are all defined based on semi-empirical equations that may have specific ranges of applicability. And so one really interesting aspect of our sediment transport model in relation to some of these transport equations is that we do provide users capability to customize the code to enter different bed load, entrainment, or settling equations if needed. So this can make a really interesting platform for various types of research applications where you're looking to evaluate new sediment transport models. So now let's walk through a real example setup just to give you an idea of what exactly is going to be involved in getting one of these models up and running. So we'll go through the example setup of that simple flow over a weir where we have a falling jet impinging on an erodible boundary. So this is going to create an erosive force that's acting on the boundary where the scour hole will continue to grow until an equilibrium depth is reached. So just note that this is a conceptual level example that's intended to highlight some of the key elements of the model in order to demonstrate how it works. So with this example, we'll go through how to activate all the necessary sediment transport physics. We'll also show how we can specify an erodible bed or packed geometry component, how we can define boundary conditions to include suspended sediment concentrations, and then also take a look at how we can analyze and evaluate results. Also note that this is one of the prepackaged examples available in Flow-3D Hydro. So if you do have an active license, then you should be able to load up all of these setup files directly into the GUI. So whenever we're doing any type of advanced physics simulation, such as sediment transport, it's always good practice to gradually add complexity. So this allows us to incrementally check our results before moving on to the final setup and generally help avoid making unnecessary mistakes. So typically for most multi-physics simulations, the first step is going to be to set up a general free surface simulation. So these will be the same setup procedures that we went over in the first two webinars. So if you need additional detail about setting up this type of simulation, I suggest going back and reviewing those webinars. But in general, some of the key features to this specific example will be creating geometry using Flow-3D primitive objects. I've defined a simple uniform mesh, added initial conditions for fluid inside the domain, and then for boundary conditions, defined a volume flow rate on the upstream side, and then a pressure with a fixed fluid elevation on the downstream side. So fairly simple setup for the hydraulics in this particular case. And so after running the simulation, you can review the results before moving on to activate the sediment model. And so the hydraulics results from this step are going to be the basis for all of the sediment calculations once we activate that model. So we want to make sure that we're following all the best practices for our free surface setup, perform any necessary V&V, as the sediment model results can really only be as accurate as the hydraulic solution. So anything within the model setup that's potentially affecting the bed shear stress is going to have a direct effect on scour processes for bed load and entrainment. Likewise, anything affecting the general scalar transport is also going to have an effect on suspended sediment transport. So some critical aspects of the model setup that are going to be important at this stage, of course, are going to be the accuracy of any geometry components, the mesh design, including things like cell size and aspect ratios, the types of boundary conditions defined and where they're located at, and then also turbulence model options and other types of numerical options that you might consider for any type of free surface simulation. So again, it's very important to think carefully about the different aspects of your model setup, sources of uncertainty, and how these things can affect the specific goals and objectives of your simulation before moving on to activate the sediment model. So then once we're happy with the hydraulic solution, we can move on to actually activate the sediment model. So the general process to set up and activate the sediment model is quite simple. Within the physics doc widget, we'll define all of the sediment properties. This will activate all the different sediment species, define the types of transport equations we want to use. And then from there, we'll move on to the geometry doc widget, where we need to define which of the geometry components will represent the erodible or packed bed portions of the simulation. And then we can also define initial and boundary conditions to include suspended sediment concentrations. Okay, so now let's move over to the GUI and actually take a look at how we can do this. All right, so now with the GUI open, we can see we already have our free surface hydraulic simulation set up and ready to go, just like we described earlier. But let's just go ahead and take a quick look through the model setup and verify everything that was discussed. So this was created using the free surface setup template. And moving over to the model setup tab, we can start in the global doc widget and see that this is set up for a 30-second finish time. And then moving on to the physics tab, you can see our free surface physics are defined with gravity, turbulence, and the one fluid VOF options. And then moving down to the geometry doc widget, so we've created a weir and channel using Flow-3D primitive objects. And then within the meshing doc widget, you can see we have a single uniform mesh around the entire domain. For the boundary conditions, there's a volume flow rate defined on the upstream side with a natural inlet fluid elevation. And then on the downstream side, we have a pressure outlet with a defined elevation to represent a subcritical flow outlet. And then lastly, for our initial conditions, we've defined a global elevation to correspond with the downstream boundary and then a fluid region to fill the area upstream of the weir. And so as we discussed before, we want to make sure that we evaluate all the results from our hydraulic solution before moving on to the sediment transport setup. But once we feel good here, we can actually just set up our sediment run by making a restart of this existing simulation. So this would allow us to continue running from the results of the hydraulic simulation with sediment activated. Or we can actually just copy this and start from time equals zero, which is what we'll do in this case. Okay, so after creating a copy of this simulation, let's move over to the model setup tab. And then the first place that we'll start is go to the physics doc widget and open up the sediment transport options. So within this sediment transport physics dialog, we're going to define all the properties of our sediment and also select any necessary options for each of the individual transport processes. So the first thing that we'll want to do is actually activate the sediment model by clicking this checkbox. And then with the sediment model active, the next thing we'll want to do is define our sediment species. So a sediment species defines the properties of a class of sediment. So this can include things like grain size, density, and also some input parameters for bed load entrainment and angle of repose. So at a minimum, you'll need at least a single sediment species. So this would represent a uniform grain size distribution. Otherwise, we can define up to 10 different species to represent a variable grain size distribution. So for this example, I'm just going to activate three species and define three different grain sizes for coarse sand, fine gravel, and median gravel. So next we can see we have three different options that we can select for bed load sediment transport. And also note that for each sediment species, you can modify the bed load transport coefficient and also the entrainment coefficient. And then also for each sediment species, we have to define a critical dimensionless shear stress. So this can be defined automatically using the Soulsby-Whitehouse equation, or we can choose to define this manually for each one of our grain sizes. So the critical dimensionless shear stress defines the required force for incipient motion of a given particle size, and it's going to be used in both the bed load and entrainment equations. And you can also see you have an option to modify the dimensionless shear stress based on a given bed slope. So in an adverse slope, it will actually increase the required shear stress to initiate motion, and in a downward slope, it'll be decreased. Okay, then moving to the right, you can see we have a few different options for the settling and advection of suspended sediment. So we can activate the Richardson-Zaki correlation to account for hindered settling effects for high sediment concentrations. So with increased concentration, the settling velocity is actually going to decrease. And then we can also define molecular and both turbulent diffusion coefficients or multipliers. Just note that the turbulent diffusion multiplier is actually the inverse of the Schmidt number, which defines the ratio of turbulent diffusion to sediment mass diffusion. Okay, then the last option that we have is we can define the bed surface roughness to be a function of the D50. So this will override any surface roughness that you set on the geometry properties, and of course will be used in the wall functions for the turbulence model. And then we can also define the max packing fraction. So this will account for porosity within the bed, or the open space between individual sand grains within the packed bed. So for example, in the case of perfectly packed spheres, we'll only be occupying 64% of the possible area with 36% porosity. Okay, so all these options here are obviously quite important for setting up and running your model, but a more detailed discussion really goes beyond the scope of what we can get into in today's webinar. So for more details, I suggest reviewing the user manual, also the available tech notes, and also some of our advanced training sessions on the sediment model. Likewise, these are also topics for which you might want to contact our tech support if you're looking into using the model. Okay, then moving back out to the physics tab, you'll also see that the variable density model has now automatically been activated. And so for the sediment model, our default behavior is actually to have the fluid density to be modified by suspended sediment concentrations. Okay, then next we'll move over to the geometry dock widget and define which of the geometry components are going to be erodible, or what we call packed bed. So here we can see that we have two different geometry components. We'll leave the first component set to a solid or general geometry object. So that's the weir component. So we don't want that to be erodible. And then for component two, let's go ahead and change that to a packed bed component type. So this tells the solver that these geometry objects are going to be erodible with our sediment transport model. And then next, for the packed bed component, let's go ahead and click on that first subcomponent underneath it. So here we can see we have packed bed properties that can be defined, where we can set the bed composition for each one of the sediment species that we created in the physics dialog. So by default, they're going to be evenly distributed among all three of the sediment species, but you could, of course, set a specific percentage for each one of these species. We can also define multiple subcomponents if you wanted to add some spatial variability for how each sediment species was distributed. And then moving over to the boundary conditions, we can define a suspended sediment concentration for any of our inlets. So going to the XMEN with the volume flow rate inlet, let's go to the auxiliary properties and define an inlet concentration of, let's say, 43 kilograms per cubic meter for the fine sand fraction, or I'm sorry, the coarse sand fraction. Okay, then we can also do the same thing for our initial conditions, but let's just go ahead and leave these as zero for this example. Okay, then moving over to the output options, let's make sure that we activate our sediment outputs and also fluid density. And then we can also go into the numerics tab, and here let's just go ahead and set second order monotonicity preserving for the advection method, and also turn off the IBM or immersed boundary method for this case. Okay, so now let's move back out to the sim manager tab. Our model setup is done, and we can choose to run this simulation. And should just take a few minutes to run on most of your average workstation PCs. So then to finish up the setup example, let's just go ahead and move over to Flow-3D Post and take a look at some of the different output options that we have for data analysis. So Flow-3D Post is our advanced post processor, and this is going to give us a lot of flexibility for how we want to evaluate the results. So from the full results files, we can create a variety of different 3D views, slices, vector fields, volume renders, 1D plots, and other types of output options for both the sediment and hydraulic data. And so especially with a sediment transport model, there's going to be so much data available, so many related interactive processes. It's really important to have an efficient way to evaluate these results. Okay, so within Flow-3D Post, I have already pre-configured a few different views for both the hydraulics and sediment output. So let's start by taking a look at some of the hydraulic data. Okay, so of course, all of the hydraulic results are going to be very critical since they drive all of the sediment transport functions. So here we can see a few different 3D renderings of the 3D velocity field. So it's going to include a 3D plot of the flow vectors colored by also colored by flow velocity, 3D isosurface of the fluid also colored by velocity, and then the packed bed colored by shear stress. And so all of these views are linked together. So whenever we pan, rotate, or zoom, we can do a side-by-side comparison of each. And then down below, you can see we also have that 2D clip of the velocity profile right down the center line. So again, a lot of different options for evaluating the model hydraulics. So 3D renderings, 2D clips, velocity vectors, all of these can be really valuable for those purposes. Okay, then we can move over to our next view that we have configured to take a look at changes to the packed bed. So here we've also have a 3D rendering where the packed bed is colored by the net elevation change. So the red regions are areas that are experiencing scour and the blue deposition relative to the original bed elevation. Here you can see the water just shown as a reference. It's given some transparency and a solid color so we can really focus on the bed changes here. Then down below, you can see we have a plan view of the packed bed, just another way to view these results. And then in the bottom right, we also have another plan view, but it's colored by the average rate of change. So just another way to evaluate which areas are experiencing the most rapid change to the bed elevation. And then also included here are some 1D plots of the total sediment mass in the domain and also the sediment mass for the packed bed and suspended mass. And we can see how these are changing over the course of the 30-second simulation. Okay, then now taking a look at the suspended sediment output, here we can see a 3D volume rendering. So this is a little bit different from a 3D isosurface. With a volume rendering, we're actually displaying all cells within the domain, and we're adding a little bit of transparency so we can see into the interior. So it can be a really powerful way for viewing things like scalar concentrations or this suspended sediment concentration. Likewise, 2D clips are also another really good way to see what's happening inside the fluid. So in this case, we've got the profile clip and these cross-sectional clips showing the sediment concentration. Okay, then lastly, we can take a look at changes to grain size distribution by plotting the D50 right onto the packed bed. Again, we also show in the water surface with some transparency so we can focus on changes to the packed bed. And then in the bottom right, we also have some 1D plots of sediment mass for each one of the individual sediment species. So we can see the changes in both the packed bed and also the suspended sediment concentration for all the coarse sand, fine gravel, and medium gravel grain size fractions. So now let's move back over to the PowerPoint and take a look at a few validation studies. So first, let's take a look at some of our past validation results for a simple pier scour validation case. So in this study, our goal was to evaluate the capability of Flow-3D to predict scour and deposition magnitudes and patterns for bridge piers or similar type obstructions. So in general, this was done by validating Flow-3D simulation results that were set up based on some previous experimental data that was collected in other studies. So in this case, we had equilibrium scour measurements for different shaped piers in an otherwise uniform flume condition with uniform sand size particles. So a Flow-3D model was set up to replicate the conditions from the flume study, and then the numerical results are going to be compared against the measured data. So the first step, of course, was to set up the hydraulic simulation with some of the details outlined below. And then on the right, you can see some of the simulation results from the hydraulics-only model and some of the really interesting vortex shedding pattern that can be observed even in this really simple configuration. Okay, then we activate the sediment model and compare results for both the cylindrical and diamond-shaped pier cases. So first, let's take a look at the results from the cylindrical pier case. So on the bottom right, we can see a 3D view of the equilibrium bed topography. And then on the left, we can see a plan view comparing the physical model measurements versus the Flow-3D results. So the first thing to note is that with the numerical model, I think we're doing a really great job of replicating the overall scour and deposition patterns. Additionally, that maximum scour depth also matches very closely. So within about 10%, comparing the measured versus modeled max scour depth. Then the overall scour patterns, I think, compare very closely, perhaps with the exception at the nose of the pier, where we're slightly under-predicting the scour at this location, but this is something that has been commonly observed with other 3D sediment transport models. And then also with the deposition, the patterns are represented quite closely with the location shifted in the downstream direction. And then in the graph on the top right, we're comparing the maximum scour depth as it's changing over the course of the simulation. So the red line represents the FLOW-3D results, and each of the black dots represent measurements from the physical modeling data. And so you can see there's rapid scouring occurring over the first 10 to 20 minutes with FLOW-3D tracking those measured points very nicely. And then the maximum deposition height from the FLOW-3D model is also plotted along just as a reference here. Okay, then now let's look at a different shaped pier. So we're going to apply the exact same setup specifications, just changing out the pier geometry from a cylindrical to a diamond shaped pier. So again, we can see a 3D isometric view of the equilibrium scour topography on the bottom right. And then on the left, we can see a plan view comparing the modeled versus the measured data. Again, a really great overall agreement for pier scour and shape. So the maximum scour depth matched very closely from the model to the experimental data, so within about 5%. And also the overall deposition pattern, I think, also matched really closely, but again, with that location of the maximum deposition shift in the downstream direction. And then on the top right, you can also see a comparison of how that maximum scour depth changed as a function of time over the course of the simulation. So again, the simulation results as the red line, tracking the measured data very closely through the entire simulation period. And then, of course, one of the major challenges for any sediment model is how to handle uncertainty for many of the different model inputs. And so as part of this study, we performed an extensive sensitivity test looking at both factors that affect the hydraulics, so the cell size and also roughness height. So these are two things that may have an important effect on boundary shear stress. And then also some of the sediment model inputs, such as the bed load transport equation and also the critical dimensionless shear stress. But to summarize the results from this study, overall, we had really good predictions for the maximum scour depth and deposition, and also patterns for the range of conditions that were tested. And then some of the specific challenges with this study included input sensitivities related to things driving the boundary shear stress, so mesh size, roughness height, and also inputs for the sediment model, such as bed load equation and dimensionless critical shear stress. So this was a very brief summary of this validation study. For additional details, for a more thorough description of the model setup and also analysis, I'd recommend checking out the paper linked here at the bottom of the slide. Okay, then let's quickly take a look at one more validation case, this being a validation that we've recently been working on for the scour hole development in a 2D plunging jet. So similar to the conceptual example that we set up earlier, this case shows a plunging jet for flow over a vertical weir, where this jet impinges on the channel bed, where it creates a scour hole that's going to grow until an equilibrium depth is achieved. So the model was set up in Flow-3D to replicate the physical modeling experiments described in See It All from 2018. And so using this laboratory data, we're able to compare the simulated scour hole development in Flow-3D to measurements collected in the laboratory. And so in the plots on the right, we can see the simulated maximum scour hole development as the red line, and then each of the blue circles corresponding to measurements from the experimental study. And here we can see an extremely close correspondence between the Flow-3D simulated scour depth versus what was being measured in the laboratory. And so I would like to note that these are preliminary results, but the model was set up and run using mostly default options with a little minor tuning to the roughness height coefficient. So we do have plans to continue working on this case, and we'll plan to present a more thorough validation sensitivity test here in the future. And then also really interested in comparing some of the resulting flow patterns from the equilibrium scour hole development from the lab study with our Flow-3D simulation results. So on the left, we can see some Flow-3D results showing the flow patterns for plotted streamlines against some qualitative observations of the flow patterns from the physical modeling study. All right, so before we finish up, let's quickly summarize everything that we've discussed today and also touch on some of the model limitations, best practices, and general recommendations. Okay, so of course, within Flow-3D, we have advanced capabilities for 3D sediment transport modeling. So this is going to give us the capability to simulate situations where there's going to be significant 3D flow interactions with a mobile bed or suspended sediment. So the model is fully coupled with the hydrodynamic solver, so the flow field will automatically react to changes into the packed bed. We also have capabilities for bed load and suspended load transport, along with full interaction and exchange between the packed bed and suspended sediment components. So in terms of the model setup, your first step is always going to be to set up and validate the hydraulic solution before even considering the sediment transport model. So the 3D hydraulic solution is going to directly affect suspended sediment advection, also directly affect the calculation of bed shear stress, which drives all the bed load and entrainment processes used by the sediment model. So because of this, any sediment transport modeling results are going to immediately be limited by the accuracy of your hydraulic solution. So highly recommend using all of your best practices there and focusing on a good free surface simulation setup before proceeding to activate the sediment model. Okay, then once we are happy with our hydraulic solution, we can activate the sediment transport model. So we'll do this by first defining all of the sediment transport properties and transport equation parameters in the physics doc widget. And then we'll move over to the geometry doc widget and actually define the location of the packed bed and also the bed composition for the available sediment species. And then we can also define suspended sediment concentrations at the boundary conditions and also the initial conditions. And so as we showed in our example setup, the actual mechanics to get a model up and running is quite simple within Flow-3D. And so the difficulty in using this model is really going to come from evaluating and interpreting the results with a full understanding of the model limitations. Okay, so and of these limitations, the model is derived and the transport equation is defined, assuming non-cohesive sediment behavior. We also assume that sediment can be treated as a continuous media, so this is going to require that an individual grain be physically much smaller than the size of a computational cell. So if you can imagine a large gravel or boulder, and then our cell size with 1 centimeter or less, of course you wouldn't be able to erode a portion of a single particle. So generally speaking, this model is likely going to be best suited for sand and gravel packed beds, being the ideal case. But of course, this will depend on your cell size and may depend on other things like the domain size and the scale of the hydraulics that need to be resolved. And additionally, we use semi-empirical relationships to estimate the bed load transport rate, entrainment, and also settling. So especially with the bed load and entrainment equations, these are derived for a very specific range of applicability. So using these outside of that range can introduce a good amount of uncertainty. And this can often be the case where we have complex 3D hydraulics. So understanding and respecting this type of uncertainty is really going to be important for proper application of a sediment model, whether it be Flow-3D or any other sediment transport model out there. And then lastly, one important practical recommendation are going to be potential run times of these types of simulations. So with any high resolution CFD model, there's obviously going to be a much larger computational expense than for a 1D or 2D model. And so because we're running a fully coupled 3D model, we're simulating the entire scouring event. So this model is really best suited for small spatial scales over short episodic events. So things on the order of hours. If you're looking to do sediment studies over a larger domain or over time scales of weeks, months, or years, not something I would recommend doing with our fully 3D model. These types of applications would likely be better suited towards our shallow water model. But discussing the sediment transport capabilities for a shallow water model will need to be a separate topic for a separate presentation. So other general recommendations and best practices. If you're a new user, I'd highly recommend becoming proficient with setting up and running general 3D free surface simulations first before taking on a sediment transport model. I think this will highly increase your probability of success as opposed to just jumping in right to the sediment model as a new user. And then as we've talked about, all sediment models do contain a high degree of uncertainty, whether it be Flow-3D or other types of software. So always recommend to use cautious engineering judgment when setting up these models and interpreting the results. Quite often the best use for sediment models is going to be for qualitative evaluation or comparative analysis, as opposed to direct calculation of absolute erosion or deposition. Additionally, highly recommend performing your own verification validation. I think that's the best way to learn how to use the model and become comfortable with the range of outputs and application of the model. And lastly, I'd always highly encourage users to contact sales or support for a pre-project consultation where we can help evaluate the use of this model or really any other model for your particular application. Okay, then before we finish up, just a reminder about our online workshop. So if you're interested in learning a little bit more about Flow 3D, and also getting your hands on an evaluation license, I highly recommend getting signed up for one of these online classes, with the next one coming up in August. Okay, so that's all we have for today. Thanks again for attending. And if you have any questions or comments, feel free to reach out to me directly at brian.fox@flow3d.com. Thank you.